Now let me go ahead and think about cases where the marginal external cost isn't constant. So, in the previous examples, I assumed that the amount of incremental harm that each unit did, as measured by the amount of harm it did, was constant. So the first unit did, say, $10 of harm, and the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth unit did $10 of harm, and the seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth, 11th, 12th unit also did $10 of harm. So if we were drawing a graph of the marginal external cost, it would look like that. It would be flat. And in that case, having every unit of the externality taxed at the same amount makes sense because they all have an equal impact. And in that case, things are relatively simple. But a lot of things out there, so quantity of the externality, and something to do with dollars up here, a lot of things, it might be that, you know, the first little bit of manure or fertilizer or whatever we put in the river, you know, it doesn't do very much harm. And the second unit does more harm. And the third unit does even more harm than that, and so on and so forth. So this is sort of a case where it's relatively painless to tolerate small amounts of it, but as we get to more and more saturation of the pollution, we sort of get into a situation where things are more complicated. It might even be that, you know, well, maybe we can tolerate, maybe there's sort of a safe threshold where the harms associated with the pollution are zero for a while, and then it shoots up rapidly or something like that. So, you know, it could be, you know, we're safe up to here, and then things rapidly get worse, and as we go towards this level of the externality, everyone starts dying because it just gets totally toxic. So this curve, it could have this nice flat shape. More realistically, it probably has some sort of more complicated shape out there. So how do we find the efficient level of pollution? And you know, sometimes when people see things phrased that way, they go, well, the efficient level of pollution is zero. Pollution's bad, so we should go ahead and have zero pollution. Well, that doesn't necessarily hold true. As one economist said, what's the efficient level of dirt in your house? So it's clear that dirt is bad, or mess is bad, but since it's costly to clean up mess and dirt, you don't necessarily want to push the level of dirt or mess all the way to zero. You want to push it down to some tolerable level. So that's sort of the idea here. We want to engage in a kind of cost-benefit analysis of which units of pollution do more harm than they allow us good. And of course, emitting pollution allows us to create goods and services which people value. The way to think about this is to do something like the following. Here we're going to think about the output market for a product. And so this is the quantity of output. And I'm going to go ahead and say it's pork. And over here we have the amount, it's not really a market, of pig manure that, say, runs off a farm and gets into a creek. And the output market for pork, you know, has nice normal demand curves and supply curves, and we know all about demand curves and supply curves. And how do we think about the benefits and costs over in this other diagram? The benefits of producing the first level of pork are going to be the total gains from trade created by that first level of pork. And that looks like one, and we'll take it even all the way from here to there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, I think. So, I think that's 15. 3, 6, 9, 12. So, the first unit of pork creates $15 of gains from trade, so that's the benefit of the first unit of production. So the benefit of a unit of the externality equals the gains from trade allowed by emitting that level of pollution, or emitting that unit of pollution. And you can see here then that the second unit has lower benefits associated with it because seller costs are a little bit higher and buyer value is a little bit lower. So let's go ahead and say that it's $2 lower, and then so on and so forth. So as we're moving to these later units, we're moving to units where the gains from trade are smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until the gains from trade here are actually zero. So testing my art skills again. Because these each have slope of basically 1 and negative 1, it's declining $2 for every one here. Okay, so this is the marginal benefit of emitting the pollutant. So it's not that the pollutant is actually beneficial, but again, emitting the pollutant does allow us to produce some delicious bacon, and we get some gains from trade from producing that bacon. And then we would sort of think about, well, what are the harms here? Well, and maybe the harms curve looks like this. So this curve would reflect the marginal external costs of emitting the pollutant. So then the efficient amount of the pollutant is right here, because all the units to the left of here have a marginal benefit of creating that pollutant greater than the marginal external cost, and all the units over here have a marginal benefit less than the marginal external costs. So here's our efficient amount of the pollutant. How do we get people to produce that amount? We set the price of pollution to this amount. So if we charge people a tax for their pollution, we want to charge the tax of this amount here, because that'll deter the right amount of pollution. Notice that if we don't tax people at all, people will want to pollute as long as there's any benefit to doing so. So, at least in this particular case, this would be the market equilibrium amount of pollution right here.